of all, I've just got to make a confession ahead of time. I'm a very stubborn personality, and I've been determined to get all the information I want to share into an 18-minute talk. And as stubborn as I am not accomplishing that very well. So I have been presenting for 48 years, and in those 48 years, I've never studied notes. I'm going to try to do this presentation in 18 minutes by looking at notes and presenting from them. So I apologize ahead of time. But I have an area that I've just become so excited about. Man, the understanding of the impact of airwave problems, of having treated for 48 years patients that I recognized the problem, but I didn't understand it at the level that I do now. And wanting to share with you that in our collaboration, we as physical therapists that are trained in this area can really help your patient. So I've tried to cram in a 12-minute video that I'm going to show you so that you can understand, because you can't explain what you can't see. And so I'm going to try to get to that video as soon as possible once I figure out where to go here. But first of all, thank you, Dr. Hendon and Dr. Gelb, for inviting me. And I want to thank Brad Gilden for introducing me to this area. First of all, instead of viewing patients with airway insufficiency on a local level, we are really beginning to look at it globally, from the feet up. But particularly in this talk, I want to talk about the pressure systems of the abdomen, the thorax, and the pharynx, how they affect airway problems and how they affect the system as a whole. And this systematic approach is geared toward postural and functional capacity, the airway's capacity, and the motor control components of respiration. Therefore, I'd like to propose that manual physical therapy is an emerging field of expertise that be integrated into these patients' medical and dental care. The next phase is just to acknowledge the book GASP, how much it informed me, how I use it as education in all of the continuing education classes I teach in this area, and it's required for my fellows in the fellowship program. But why are we interested in the pressure systems? Well, because they provide structure through which function and respiration occur. The three major cavities which maintain pressure are the abdomen, thorax, and the oropharyngeal region. These pressures are regulated by the structures that you see listed below, which I'll cover more in depth later. So what do the pressure systems accomplish for the function and airways efficiency? They provide a stable structure for the postural muscles to stabilize the body, and these pressures are regulated by the tongue, the glottis, the diaphragm, and the pelvic floor. Dysfunction in any one of these can seriously affect airway efficiency. A groundbreaking article was published in 2013 by Hodges and Massery related to the regulation of pressure in the thoracic cavity by the glottis and the diaphragm, which dysfunctional states can lead to airway challenges. Massery used a Coke can with the top of it being the glottis to demonstrate the stability, and when that can is opened, how it can be unstable. Same thing can be looked at with a flat tire on a bicycle. There's been extensive research into the importance of postural alignment and postural role in airways insufficiency. And I will be showing a video later, as I already said, and treatment of each of these components which regulate pressure, and you can see each one of the components that I've got listed there. Our approach to manual therapy addresses the mechanical capacity initially, which is basically the mobility of the joints, the fascia, the muscles, the neurovascular structures, the visceral structures. And then we address the neuromuscular function. How well do core muscles actually contract? Do they have a core intact? How is it affected by their autonomic function? Are we going to have to deal with their vagus nerve and their autonomic issues? And then how is this timed with the core muscle facilitation? And then training of those muscles to be able to facilitate efficient motor control. Take a look at these individual postures here, and you see the variation that can occur in posture. Each one of them, you can see how the pressure systems are either aligned like the one on the left, or on the ones on the right, some of the problems. My wife, Vicki Saliba Johnson, has published an article on the Saliba Postural Classification System that helps us to better identify postural dysfunctions in the thoracic cage and provide us mechanisms for being able to manage them. I love this picture of the Marine recruits to see the variety in them and to really see, are they protecting us? And look at the mouth breathers, the postural dysfunctions. It's pretty amazing. So our initial goal is to enhance posture and respiration function through treatment and training. We use the vertical compression test to be able to effectively see how weight is distributed through that system. And we identify points in which that system in an upright posture does not have efficient alignment. We then go into a training phase. We either treat mechanical dysfunctions or in sitting and in standing, we train the patient to have the kinesthetic awareness of the new position. We train the core muscles in that new position so that their posture immediately changes because they have a new paradigm for what posture is. A very quick study of a man 83 years old that I treated who was really complaining of neck pain, loss, fatigue, memory loss, but disrupted sleep. And I just want to show you, each one of these were dramatically improved over a period of about 6 weeks with treatment. And I think you can see the dramatic change in his posture through manual therapy and PNF approach. Now, just looking quickly, and I'm almost out of my time, so I'm going to have to move through most of this very quickly here. The oral cavity is what is so fascinating to me, and to really understand how it's developed through breastfeeding and how it facilitates our developmental sequence and how we understand that our developmental sequence goes from cephalo to caudate. And so if we do not develop our tongue, if we don't allow that most advanced muscle at birth to be further developed, we limit it. And most of our patients that we will see in the person in the video you'll see was not breastfed. And so we're getting so much into this and the identification of the rugae and the rest position of the tongue and what that should be. So I'm going to skip by all of these various different pictures here. Just mentioned to you the glottal effort closure reflex because it's very important. When we effort, our glottis should close and we should have our pharynx in a strong contraction to provide an anterior structure. Many of us don't have that. Many of us after an accident lose it. And what we really want to do is help them to redevelop this. And we see in our sleep apnea patients, getting the glottal closure reflex back often accelerates their improvements. So, pelvic floor and diaphragm being an important aspect because they're diagonal functioning structures. And we spend a lot of time with our patients teaching them sleep positions and training them in effective sleep. And a lot of times, they will improve dramatically just through this training. Thank you very much for your patience as I work my way through this.